Tarmac.
Let's face it, the media gets a lot wrong when it comes to aviation.
The pilot of a twin-engine plane making an emergency landing on Crescent Beach.
From simple things you could ask any enthusiast.
All white, the plane is too high. All red, too low. White and red means it's the right path.
To things that make you wonder if the editors have ever been on an airplane. Sometimes facts right there in the story are even misquoted.
A frightening ride for 136 passengers on board a JetBlue flight.
In this episode, let's take a look at the top 7 things the media gets wrong about aviation. When it comes to aviation, the internet going public isn't too much better either.
The massive chemtrail that it was dropping behind it. People, you need to pay attention because this...
Anyone is capable of turning regulation holding patterns into sensational news.
I don't know.
But there is usually an easy explanation for those in the know. For example, this plane seen circling dangerously low over a highway is actually a banner towing pilot having a difficult time hooking his banner. It can take several tries on a windy day. Let's also not forget the occasional news piece with exceptional reporting by aviation experts.
Now watch how he feathers those props. All right, engine stops, but very smart move. Okay, now hold it, get it as slow as you can, slow it down.
You can watch this one here. But I won't keep you waiting on the tarmac any longer. Let's get to number 1. We've all heard it 1,000 times, but we'll never really know how it got started. As far as your pilot is concerned, no part of an airport is referred to as the tarmac, but it seems to be the only part of an airport that reporters are familiar with. That and the runway, of course, which is also frequently misused and abused. If you're waiting on a plane and it's not currently on fire, you're probably not on a runway. You're likely on a taxiway, ramp, or apron. Taxiways are used for getting to and from runways, and they're highly controlled areas, much like runways. Ramps and aprons are large open areas where you see ground crews and equipment milling about and servicing aircraft. Number 2. Whenever there's an incident with a private airplane, the media is always quick to announce that the pilot was flying without a flight plan, in a manner leading us to believe that this is illegal or at least careless. In reality, most private pilots never file a flight plan. These small private aircraft are usually engaged in flight training or are simply flying around for fun with no particular schedule. The FAA encourages these so-called VFR pilots to file flight plans, both as a record of their due diligence and as a guide for search and rescue teams should something happen. But in our day of GPS and accurate weather forecasting, these services have fallen by the wayside. It's always a good idea to file a flight plan if you're traveling long distances, especially over water or rural areas, but it's largely impractical for pilots only flying in their local area or for training flights that have no destination, but might be training in several areas throughout the day. Number 3. As far as reporters are concerned, a single-engine airplane is a dangerous rich boy's toy, and they range in size from single-passenger ultralights to luxury miniature airliners and everything in between. At their smallest, single-engine aircraft can be a home-built craft with fabric wings and a two-stroke engine like a lawnmower. The majority are 2-, 4-, and 6-seat FAA-certified aircraft that undergo annual inspections, have thousands of dollars of instrumentation on board, and usually have basic safety features. At the top end of the spectrum are what can only be described as private jets. They may have a propeller, but they're powered by a single jet turbine engine, just like airliners have. These aircraft are anything but small and dangerous, weighing over 5 tons fully loaded, with a price tag of about $5 million. For your comparison, you can find some ultralights that weigh less than me. Number 4. Every year there are a few incidents that happen with student pilots flying without an instructor. If you've never thought about learning to fly before, this might also sound incredibly illegal. How can you fly an airplane without a license, you might think? In fact, about half of all the time someone spends learning to fly is done solo, without an instructor in the airplane. As long as you have your instructor's written approval, you can practically do everything that a licensed pilot can, with the exception of carrying passengers. Flying solo is a major milestone for student pilots, since 100% of the responsibility for the flight is on their shoulders. This is called being the pilot in command. Chances are very good that several student pilots fly over your house every day without an instructor on board, and unfortunately, the aircraft doesn't care who's flying it. Mechanical failures, and subsequently ending up on the 7 o'clock news, are just as likely to happen with or without an instructor on board. Number 5. Another typical scare tactic you will hear on the news is a reporter acting shocked at the age of an airplane in question. Who would drive a car from 1965, let alone an airplane, right? According to the General Aviation Manufacturers Association, the average age of a single-engine aircraft in 2015 was 45.4 years, meaning they were manufactured in late 1969. It's a long story, but due to the economics of the aviation industry, a new version of almost the exact same airplane built by the same factory today can cost well over $250,000, making them completely unachievable for most pilots, compared to the older models which cost less than luxury car brands. The age of the airplane, however, has almost no bearing on its safety, since they're torn down and rebuilt by mechanics at the slightest indication of a problem, and the engines are usually replaced or overhauled every few years. In the case of the airplane that you might be familiar with seeing on this channel, almost no original parts remain on the aircraft with the exception of the frame, landing gear, and wing structure. Everything else has been replaced over time. These airplanes typically rack up more than 5,000 flight hours by 2017, and they're still considered safe over 10 times that. Number 6. This one is plain and simple. Not all aircraft have black boxes. Light aircraft almost never do. Private jets, even, typically will only have them as a factory option until they carry enough passengers. Black boxes consist of a flight data recorder and a cockpit voice recorder. Smaller aircraft can be more easily equipped with the latter, making them more common, but their quality varies. Most of the private aircraft fleet in the world is not equipped with either, so don't bother looking for them at the scene of a crash. What almost all aircraft are equipped to have, though, is an emergency locator transmitter. This may resemble a black box, since they're frequently painted yellow or orange and usually located in the plane's tail. They can either be triggered manually or automatically on impact, and they transmit an audible siren on an emergency radio frequency that will hopefully be detected for miles around, since all aircraft and air traffic control facilities are required to monitor this frequency whenever possible. Number 7. Lastly, the media likes to portray every landing of an airliner that catches their attention as an emergency landing. This typically conjures images from blockbuster movies capitalizing on the public's fear of flying and drama in the air. But the vast majority of so-called emergency landings are just precautionary. Your pilots are trained to use their best judgment to keep you safe, so they would rather return to sender than to get over the ocean and discover the problem is much more severe than they suspected. Furthermore, a true emergency is only present when the pilots declare one to air traffic control. In this case, the pilot is authorized to break any aviation regulation in the name of safety, so long as they can explain it well later. If the flight crew simply wants to land sooner rather than later, and have a problem looked at by their maintenance crews, they don't have to declare an emergency. They can just land normally, like they've done thousands of times before. Complain as we do, aviation is a complex and difficult to understand industry, so the best we can do is educate ourselves and hope the media will follow suit. I hope you've learned something about aviation today, and that you'll share this information with anybody who might be interested in what really goes on behind those sensational news stories. Until next time on the Friendly Skies channel, squawk VFR and have fun.